Namaste. Welcome to United Hospital. Thank you for joining with us this afternoon. We have with us Dr. Karthik Hunse.
Hello.
Consultant orthopedic surgeon and joint replacement. Welcome, doctor.
Thank you, ma'am.
Today we are going to discuss about first hit geriatric trauma. Doctor, can you please tell us what is geriatric trauma?
See, geriatric trauma basically is what we are dealing with the geriatric patients, the elderly patients, your parents, your grandparents. These are the patients whom we will be concentrating today, and the talk will be basically based around them. Most of the elders at home, they have a slip, fall in the bathroom while climbing down the stairs, and these are the things what we see. When they have these type of injuries, the most common injuries seen is around the hip joint, the shoulder joints, around the spine, ankle. These are the commonest areas where they have the first hit. Most common is the spine and the hip. That's how our patients present to us in the emergencies. Okay. So this is what we're going to be talking about, a geriatric trauma.
Okay. What are the do's and don'ts people face at home?
See, geriatric trauma is a thing which has to be, identified at the right time so that we don't face problems in the future. Okay. And these days many elderly are staying alone, and if it is not picked up, they are lying down at home without any first aid or at least emergency treatment available to them. So what we see here is, one thing first is identify what is the problem they have.
Okay.
Assess the situation, which joint or shoulder, hip or whatever part of the body has been injured. First immobilize this or splint it. If you can't do anything, best thing is, in whatever position the patient is keeping his joint or the limb, allow him to continue in that position, because that is the least painful position what the patient would have automatically kept the limb in.
Okay.
So once this is there, at least an ice pack or an icing at that area can reduce their pain. And by that time you can organize ambulance or the nearest hospital staff, somebody to be called, and shift the patient at the earliest to the nearby hospital.
Okay.
With this, we are buying a lot of time in diagnosing and treating these fractures. And most important is, you assess the patient in whatever way available in and around your premises to see that he doesn't waste so much of time at home and we lose that golden period of saving them. So let it be a small injury, head injury or a hip fracture, whatever it is. But if there is a head injury and if it's not picked up at right time, they'll end up into a lot of problems in the future. Maybe they may get paralyzed, or maybe they'll lose the power of one of the limbs, all these things. So basically, geriatric trauma is to deal with these fractures at the earliest, with whatever complications they have or whatever comorbidities they have. We want to make their life more independent and pain-free.
Okay. Now, what are the problems faced by the doctor while planning to treat these kind of patients at the hospital setup?
See, it's a Himalayan task of, the problems. The problems are so much, because they have elderly patients who present to us, either they have diabetes, hypertension, cardiac problems, renal problems, liver problems, and all those things. Whole sea of problems they have. But with all these things, as doctors, we want to give them a better life with taking whatever risks is there, and it will be a calculated risk. We assess the patient. We don't take a patient immediately for a surgery unless until it is a dire emergency. Otherwise, we have enough time for us to assess the patient by our various multi-speciality doctors or various other field by our physician, cardiologist, anesthetist. Everybody works it up, and then we assess the risk that if taken up for this surgery, will he have any problems? Most of the time it will be an yes, but to make their life more comfortable, we have to take that risk. So all these risks are taken, and then we plan for a surgery. Problem is, it's not planning for the surgery, it's rather than the problem arising during the surgery and post-surgery.
Okay.
Before surgery, everybody knows these are the things, these are the risks which happens.
Okay.
But during and post-surgery is the things which people have to understand, that they might, during the surgery, develop some cardiac complications or respiratory complications or kidney complications, or the BP might fluctuate, or they might bleed massively through the incision site. And post-surgery, they might bleed again, or the BP might fluctuate, their stay in the ICU might increase. The care taken post-surgery becomes, you know, you have to weigh in the way that the stay will increase, the cost will increase, the problems, psychological trauma, everything increases for the families. But at the end of the day, we want to see that with whatever risk we have taken, we want to give a good result by making them pain-free, by making them mobilize at the earliest. So if all the medical conditions and the parameters give us a clearance, next day the patient, irrespective of what fracture he has, what injury he has, we mobilize the patient. That's the best part of our development in the science which has happened in orthopedics and in orthopedic implants what we use. That gives us a confidence to use the better implant for the best of the patients, to mobilize them and get them back to their normal life at the earliest.
How to rehabilitate these kind of a patients?
Rehabilitation, as an orthopedic surgeon, I don't give a result, or I don't give a complete result. It's my team which works towards the 100% result. And the rehabilitation starts from the day the patient gets into the hospital. Let it be the physiotherapist, the physician, sometimes we require counseling, psychiatrist, help, the physician, the cardiologist. Everybody plays an important role in the development of the patient and rehabilitation of the patient to their normal life. Now, once the rehabilitation starts from day one, it's one in first before posting them for the surgery, we get them medically fit, or at least to a level where we can operate them without much problems. At that time, we start them on some physiotherapy, like chest physiotherapy, because being on the bed, within no time they can develop bed sores, infections, urine infection, motion, like the stools causing infections in and around the groin and around the buttocks. All these things are to be taken care of. So we have to keep a check on them every minute, like the BP fluctuating and all those things. Now, when rehabilitation comes, these are the things. You provide them with proper mattresses, like air beds, water beds and all, so that we avoid decubitus ulcers. That's what we call as bed sores, which happens in the gluteal regions. So decubitus ulcers, all these things has to be avoided. And because they are lying on the bed with the fracture, one, their lungs has to be functioning. Because of the pain, they start, you know, they'll be lying down, they're eating, everything is difficult. So they're eating in a propped up position. That shouldn't get aspirated. So we have to give them good chest physiotherapy, mobilization of the non-injured limbs to avoid complications like blood clotting in the lower limbs, all these things which are very risky for the life of the patient. Once the surgery is done, post-surgery, if the medical conditions allow, within 1 or 2 hours, we start the rehabilitation process. Irrespective of their age or the trauma or the injury or the fracture, whatever it is, if medical conditions allows us, then within 1 or 2 hours post-surgery, we start the mobilization. They might be under some sort of anesthesia to make them pain-free, but the limb is mobilized, or the fractured area is mobilized once the fracture is stabilized post-surgery. So with this, we attain a lot of things. One, the patient gets wonderful confidence that yes, 2 hours post-surgery, I'm already moving my limb. And with anesthesia being on, their pain is less. So they have a confidence that the pain will be less. They'll be easily able to get back to their life in coming few days or few weeks. And then once 1 or 2 days post-surgery, medically everything is fit enough, then we start them mobilizing with the help of some supports like walker, crutches. And our physiotherapy team makes a lot of difference. If the team is good enough, then we don't have any issues. it's not only the surgeon, but it's also a team which gives us the good results. So once the physiotherapy team comes in, then they start the mobilization process. Let it be climbing up the stairs, using a commode, getting up to the bed, sitting on a chair or a sofa. All these things are taken care, which is required for the basic activities once they get back to home. So we do all these things during the stay in the hospital, and post this, then we put them back into home. And even at the home, they are under our regular control. The reason being, we send a physiotherapy team to the home, or if required, a staff to do the dressings or take care of the wounds. They continue with their work at the home for, depends, for 4 weeks or 6 weeks. They rehabilitate the patient into the home and into the surroundings. Once they are more confident, they're taken outside the house to walk. And once they come back for a review after 4 weeks, we see the x-ray, the status of the union of all the fractures. Then we give them the confidence that everything is fine and they can get back to their normal life. So basically, we require that 4 to 6 weeks, the golden period, to put them back into the normal life.
There will be a few incidents like where a patient attendant do want to get operated for that patient, particular patient. Patient is stable enough to get operated. But what advice you can give to those family?
See, it's basically there will be a fear. Any person who comes and a doctor suggests a surgery to an elderly patient who might be very important for them, and then we talk about all these risks associated because of his comorbidities, then obviously that is normal. They have that fear that something might happen during or post-surgery. Then a doctor, instead of being an orthopedician, you have to become like a psychiatrist. Yes. You have to start the counseling, sit with them, spend time. Yes. That's where you can, 90% of the time you can convince. Even after that, if they don't want to get operated, we have some ways we use to manage these fractures in the earlier days with immobilization. With some, if there is a fracture in the hip, we used to put derotation boots. We used to put some plasters, casts, and all those things. But with all these things, the problem arises is the patient has to be on bed. And this is very well told to the patients, that once the patient is on bed for 4 to 6 weeks, then whatever said and done, the risk doesn't come down. It remains the same. If you mobilize, the risk might come down drastically. If you don't mobilize, then you face problems like, as I earlier told you, bed sores, urine infections, infection in the heels or sores in the heels, then aspiration. While if they're sleeping and having their food, they might aspirate, they might develop pneumonias, then their hygiene is affected. So giving them daily sponge bath, I cannot say that it's a problem, but the work on the family increases and they have to be dedicated to take care for 4 weeks to 6 weeks without developing these things, and if it develops, to be identified at the right time to take a help from the concerned doctor. So with all these things, even if they don't want to get operated, then we have to tell them the real picture in a proper way and convince them that whatever done, fracture will unite, but it will unite in the way we don't want it. So that means future rehabilitation becomes a problem and they might be restricted to their house or the bed or the room, wherein their social life is affected, and you require a 24 hours home care or somebody to take care of them all the time. So these are all the social problems what they will develop over time if not treated properly.
We have one question.
Yes.
What physiological changes in the elderly population increases the risk of traumatic injury?
Physiological changes is like if you have a car. So it's like after 50,000 kilometers, you develop tire getting, it wears out. Your engine starts giving you problem, your brakes giving you problem, your steering wheel gives you problem. So when I'm talking about a car, it also holds good to your human body. With age, there will be lot of changes in every part of the body, including joints, tissues, muscles. muscles, the quality of muscles become poor if they are not physically active, they become weak. So once they become weak, the joints become around that becomes weak. So once they have these weak joints and weak muscles, and if they trip and fall, they have a trivial fall, they'll have a major fracture. That's what you expect. And luckily, if all these things are there, not to be worried. But if the brain starts slowing down and they don't listen to you, because you're getting old, the brains also slow down. The neurons also go down. Physiologically, they also start dying. Now, once that happens, the care becomes more. And you leave them for a second, they slip or they fall, they injure. So these type of physiological changes happens from the hair to bones to skin to heart to all organs. So when these type of fractures happen, we are not only treating the fracture, we are treating the patient as a whole because of all these physiological changes. We are trying to answer all these complications which are arise because of the physiological changes of our lifestyle, of our habits, all contribute. At end of the day, we are treating only the fracture, but we are treating a lot of things, including the patient, patient's relative, and all the social problems.
We have one more question.
Yes.
What is the most common geriatric trauma?
Most common is around the hip and the spine. They develop what we call as an intertrochanteric fracture of the hip or the fracture neck of femur. If you have a fracture neck of femur, that means you cannot save the hip joint. Instead, we replace it with another artificial joint. If you have an intertrochanteric fracture, at least we can save the natural joint or the bone, put in some implants to stabilize the fracture till it heals. Second is spine, which I think will be dealt by our neuro teams. Other most common is the wrist and the shoulder, because when they fall on an outstretched hand. To avoid a fall, they give their hand to the floor. At that time, the wrist takes the brunt, and then next is the shoulder. And if you really want to see the most, after all these things, they also have associated head injuries, which is most common, and you have to assess it when they come to us. If sometimes you require a CT scan to rule out any injuries or bleeding inside the head, though they might have a small trivial injury, but it can be of a massive importance later on. You might even not know even after surgery, after 1 month. They might come back to you with irrelevant speech or confusion, all those things. So you have to check all the systems. Most common being the hip, wrist, shoulder, spine, and the ankle. You miss the knee most of the times.
Yeah. There's one more question.
Yes.
Is it required to always take elderly to any trauma centers after any falls, even if there is no major injuries?
Any hospital as such can treat any trauma. Any trauma, either if it's picked up in the earlier stage, as soon as they have it, management becomes easier. Patient suffering becomes less because we have diagnosed now. If they have a fall in the middle of the night, take to the nearest hospital immediately, you can diagnose it. Once it is diagnosed, then we can plan the process of planning, and at the earliest, once we get a clearance from our team, we can operate immediately and make them pain-free, and by next day he is already mobile. Okay. The only reason hindrance is because all the elderlies are on some sort of medications, and some medications has to be stopped for at least 4 or 5 days. Like some are taking Ecosprin or Clopidogrel for some cardiac problems. When these antiplatelet drugs are there, or blood thinning agents are there, then we require to stop these drugs before surgery. Because giving anesthesia during these times is difficult because they have their own set of problems. So this is the time where we lose, and the patient has to bear with that pain, though we give them all medicines and all those things. But we lose our time because we have to wait till these medicines are stopped and their effect goes down, and then we can take them up for surgeries.
Okay, there's one more question. Should a 70-year-old person have ACL surgery?
Very rare that we require to do an ACL surgery in elderly patients unless he is a very fit person and the cartilage is totally as new as it was 70 years back. Then we can think about it, which doesn't happen. Most of the time in elderly, we try and avoid doing these ligament reconstructions because if we put them on a proper physiotherapy and intensive exercises and build the quadriceps muscle around the knee joint, they can manage into their daily activities. Unless they are into some sorts of sports and all high demand, then we can think about it. But till today, I have not done a 70-year-old ACL. Maybe 54 is the maximum I have done because his cartilage was good, his knee was good, and he was very active into some sports, golf and all those things. So discussing with them that this will be the first time I am doing a ACL for a 54-year-old, he understood why it was done.
Okay.
Then I think it became easier for him to accept, because I wouldn't like to do a knee replacement in a 54-year-old with an ACL tear.
Okay.
When his cartilage is good. So we doing an ACL, I'm saving his natural joint for some more years. By the time he develops knee replacement, at least he would have crossed 65, 70. By that time, doing a knee replacement is the best option.
Just one more question.
Yes.
Any assessment that can be done at home?
Assessment, yes, you can do it. At least you can identify which part of the joint or the limb is affected and make them pain-free.
Okay.
And if you feel he has a head injury or he's talking irrelevant or he's confused, then the best thing is to get access to a nearby hospital, at least organize an ambulance and shift him to the nearest hospital so that we get a good time to assess him immediately with whatever investigations we can do in that hospital and manage it and prevent a further damage to his health or to him by getting a proper treatment at the right time. It's not only for the fracture, but patient as a whole. Fractures is never an emergency. You can manage it even one day later or 2 days later or 1 month later. But at least as orthopedicians, we make them pain-free till we stabilize the fracture.
There's one more question. Why trauma in the elderly is associated with higher mortality rate?
It's not the trauma associated with higher mortality. It is the age which is associated with the higher mortality with associated comorbidities, which come in the way of trauma.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when they have a fracture, that means the fracture ends are going to bleed. So that means they are going to bleed. Blood loss will be more.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if blood loss is more in a person whose hemoglobin is less, that means the hit on the body is too much. Your cardiac, your everything, all the other systems are hit. Your heart, your kidney, your liver. So that's where the mortality increases. So we have, in an elderly, in a 70-year-old, you cannot transfuse 2 or 3 units of blood immediately, one after the other.
Yes.
His heart cannot take up. So based on this, we assess, then give 1 unit, 2 units slowly over 1 or 2 days or 3 days and assess. And you have to balance between the transfusion and the patient's condition. Now, the mortality increases because that patient might have a hypertension, that patient might have a liver disease or a kidney disease or a cardiac disease. So all these things, and if a person who has a cardiac disease and 3 vessels are blocked, now if he has a hip fracture and he has to undergo a major surgery for 1 hour, obviously the mortality rate increases. So fracture is not important.
Yes.
So we have to talk about mortality. Yes, it will increase. There's no chance that you will tell he can be done under a moderate risk or a minimal risk. No, that isn't high risk. But we as doctors, with so many qualified personnel in and around us, the whole team takes care of all these problems to see that if I operate for 1 hour, that 1 hour he should be comfortably managed and he should be successful to finish the surgery, and post-operatively we can reduce the complications. So all these things, mortality 100%, it is high because of lot of factors, not the fracture as such.
Okay.
Fracture is the last thing we will be worried of.
how does trauma affect older adults?
Trauma affecting older adults is a vague question. Trauma affecting a person who is elderly is with pain, inability to do his basic activities, his risks associated if he has to undergo surgery, his dependency on the family. All these things are the factors. Trauma as such, once answered in a proper way, we reduce his dependency, make them independent, pain-free, mobile, and back to the normal life. That's what we aim at, managing trauma. It's basically the pain and the dependency. That is answered with operating on a trauma.
Thank you so much, Doctor.
Thank you.
For giving information to our viewers about the trauma care and the management.
Yes.
For the further consultation, you can to visit our hospital. We do have home care services in our hospital. So please reach out. And to watch out our further posts, please subscribe to our channel and do likes. Thank you so much. Stay safe, stay healthy.
Thank you.